So let me first start out by congratulating the three Dirac medalists here, Gabriele Veneziano, Ashoke Sen, and Andy Strominger. And it's a great honor for me to be in the company of these leaders of our field. And Gabriele in particular was really the founder in some ways with his Veneziano amplitude. And he described beautifully how all the twists and turns that the field took over the years, going from a theory of strong interactions to a theory of gravity, and back again to
the
theory.
Back again.
So maybe you want to say something about that, about history?
Yeah, well, it has been a wonderful adventure. Indeed, I like what sometimes is said. I mean, it was not an accidental discovery, this one of string theory, because we really started from a bottom-up approach. I mean, looking at the data or at the analysis of the data made by other people, trying to impose some consistency conditions, and then in the end discovering a way to describe the strong interaction processes in a way which was later understood as being related to a string structure in the strongly interacting world. And now we do believe that there is such a string structure because of quark confinement. And therefore, I mean, I think it's really rewarding to see that we were not completely out of target in those days. We were off target because it didn't quite work, but there was some truth in it, not the whole truth. So, and then indeed the field has grown in such a way that, you know, it's like your baby that you don't recognize anymore. It's gone up so much that it's very hard to. But
I think it's certainly true that it has grown into the richest theory.
Yeah, that was the title
of
my
talk. Title of your talk.
Yeah, one thing which I don't know if it's the right moment to point out is that. It is often said that string theory cannot be proven wrong, right or wrong, unless you go to gigantic energies. But I like to contend this because the old string was killed not only by high energy experiment, but also by large distance phenomena. The existence of massless spin one and spin two particles, you know, it's a problem at any energy, in particular at large distances. And string theory taken at face value in the lowest order approximation does have these extra massless states, which can violate the equivalence principle, can do a lot of harm. Mm. Now, we know that, you know, perturbation theory is not the end of the story, so hopefully these problems are solved, but it's not immediately obvious that you have to go to Planckian energy scattering to test these things.
Okay, so you would like to add something?
Well, you know, it's so interesting to listen to Gabriele's personal recollection of this, because I think it's a story that keeps repeating itself, which, you know, to hear how when he discovered the Veneziano formula, that it was a little bit of a disappointment that it didn't turn out to really describe hadrons. Of course, what it did describe, I think, is more wonderful than anything that you imagined. In the bigger picture, you can't feel any disappointment, I'm sure. And here you are, you know, getting the Dirac Medal for what it became, what the truth
That's
is.
Right. Yeah.
And I think this is a story which keeps repeating itself, that the truth about the laws of physics is more wonderful and more interesting than our imagination. Mm-hmm. And in the period of string, there was a period of, then the string theory had a new life.
That's right.
as a theory of fundamental interactions, and we had some ideas in the 80s briefly that might become an experimental reality, mm-hmm. which it hasn't. Doesn't mean the string theory mm-hmm. isn't the theory of reality, but it's not likely to become an experimental reality soon. But what has happened to it
right,
is more wonderful than what we imagined then.
Right.
Yes, we had failures, but the successes right. that replaced those failures were better. I mean, nobody would have, if somebody in 1985 or in the modern version of the story had predicted what was going to come, they would have been dismissed as optimistic fools.
That's right.
You know, that we would solve a Tuff's large N problem, that we would found new fields of mathematics, that we would understand puzzles of black holes, that we would start to glimpse a new structure, holographic structure of space-time, all from starting to think about these little oscillators. That would have seemed outrageously optimistic fantasy. Yes, we had disappointments, but one doesn't want to cling to those. What we have is better than what we hope to get. Yeah.
Yeah. So, in fact, in the subsequent developments, actually, both Andy and Ashoke, your work has been hugely influential with Calabi compactifications and black holes, and Ashoke's work on dualities and black holes. And certainly, personally, for me also, it has been a great, very influential. And Ashoke, in particular, I have collaborated with you on several things. So maybe I have a question for you about what do you see this subject of black holes where leading to and all these beautiful developments that are happening in the understanding of quantum structure of black holes? Where do you...
Yeah. I think, it's probably hard to predict where it will lead to because, it's any prediction you make in these theories...
That's the experience. It will be a lower bound on how interesting
yeah, that's right. Right. That's right, yeah. But right now, the way I see black holes is that, black holes provide us with a very useful tool for testing the internal consistency of string theory.
Mm-hmm.
Because the fact that string theory can explain so many different properties of black holes, it is unthinkable for any rival theory. I can't imagine any rival theory which come anywhere close to it. And of course, there are puzzles with black holes which are yet to be solved.
Mm-hmm.
And there are attempts to solve it. We haven't solved all the puzzles about black holes. And maybe, I don't know, again, it's hard to predict. Maybe those puzzles will not be solved, but we'll discover something
else.
Completely yeah. different and wonderful.
Yeah, so one thing that has not happened, so we certainly now seem to understand the quantum structure of black holes and even compute quantum gravity effects and holography and so on. But, and the hope was that with holography, unitarity problem of gravity would be understood, but we seem to be still quite far from it. And would you agree with this assessment? In spite of our belief that things should be unitary, we are not yet close to really proving it or showing it to be the case.
Yes, I absolutely agree with that, and that's good,
yeah.
right? Because it means that there are really significant pieces of the puzzle that we have yet to discover. It's a very sharp question,
mm-hmm.
and we have the tools to address it. Nobody has successfully wrapped it up, but it's probably, maybe I would venture to predict that we'll solve that problem in the next 10 or 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
And there's nothing stopping us from doing that.
Yeah.
And it's going to be amazing. Because it's such a deep and persistent puzzle.
Yeah.
Yeah, at least these problems are well posed, I think. Which unlike in other theories. Now
exactly.
They can be very hard. Like what happens to the singularities of general relativity. At least we can try to formulate this question.
So black hole entropy was a well-posed problem, and we do have an understanding for certain class of black holes. That's clearly it's not some problem that we invented and solved, right? I mean, it was a well-posed problem from the beginning.
By somebody else. That's certainly true that string theory has gone on to solve problems which were posed by other fields.
Yeah.
And that's a sign that we are not just fooling ourselves. So one thing that I want to ask is that, so one of the things I think where string theory still hasn't had a big impact is time dependence, understanding time dependent backgrounds, maybe like in cosmology, or also the kind of success we've had with black holes is not replicated in non-supersymmetric situations. And Andy, in your talk you presented some recent work. So do you want to say something about this direction of exploring non-supersymmetric aspects of string theory? Or,
well, I think we start on in safe territory where we understand everything very well. Those are the supersymmetric cases, and then we venture away from that step by step. And there certainly are some cases of non-supersymmetric black holes in string theory that we have the leading term for, and that is a well-posed problem. And I think that's something that we'll continue to understand more. There's a big problem that we really haven't, what one would have thought was the simplest of all black holes, the Schwarzschild black hole.
Right.
We still don't understand, and we don't understand the universality of the area law, which again, I think is an indication that there's something big that we don't understand. When we do understand it, it's not just going to be grinding through some equations. It's going to be some conceptual shift, and that's something that we could easily, I don't think it's ludicrous to think that we could be on the edge of that. So that seems promising.
But also de Sitter space, I mean, for example, explorations of that kind of, I mean, that's certainly one thing where observations are coming in thick, and string theory or early singularity. It's, of course, I know that these are very hard problems, but since you're a Dirac medalist, I can ask you this question.
Well, I want to separate two things, right? I want to separate the use of idea in string theory, the use of structures that we've discovered in string theory to solve other kinds of problems. And it's already, in cosmology, that's already happened. A lot of the discussion of three-point correlations in the CMB has somewhat been organized around things that come up only in a very sort of minor way, but that facet of things could grow. But as far as seeing, understanding some kind of stringy Big Bang,
seems
that's not going to happen
that's
soon.
That's not going to happen soon. I think it's
we're not. The astronomers are impressive at getting much more data than. Though, you know, I have to say, when I was all my life, because I worked on quantum gravity, people would say, there will never be a measurement of quantum gravity. And we did this year have a measurement
that's right.
of quantum gravity. And that was a measurement of a quantum gravitational effect.
Right.
Now, it turned out just to be an upper bound,
right.
but nevertheless,
a measurement.
It is quite plausible that They don't know whether it's oil noise or not, but it's quite plausible that within the next 10 years that there will be an actual measurement of a quantum gravity effect, something that would have seemed impossible not long ago.
Right. So, okay, finally, I guess since you have seen many ups and downs in the life of the theory, maybe I should ask this question, which is kind of a persistent question, I think, which bothers all of us, is about the vacuum selection and this plethora of landscape solutions, and which seem to prevent us from really making contact with the experiment. Mm-hmm. And what is the take of, maybe I pose this as a general question. Maybe it's a too philosophical question to ask here, but...
No, I think it's a legitimate question, for instance, in view of the fact that you could say, as a theory of quantum gravity, it's a little bit disappointing that the string theory has not shed any clear light, for instance, on the cosmological concept.
For example?
Question. And so, in fact, you could say that the only kind of light it has shed, it has to do with this landscape. Now, it's not that I'm particularly fond of this huge number of string vacua. I even hope that some of them will not survive.
Right.
And will get down to fewer.
Many of us share this.
But it is still a possibility that, that thanks to the existence of these many, many solutions and to some anthropic principle, we end up with some small value for the cosmological constant. So I'm open-minded in this respect. I'm a little bit... I think it would be nice in any case if one could find a really, out of this multitude of vacua, one which is as close as possible to what we know now. Mm-hmm. And a standard model, maybe with some extra stuff, with some extra constraints, with some extra prediction, and which includes also gravity on top of the other three fundamental interactions. I think people have made progress, but I don't think there is yet an existence proof that there is a standard model that comes from string theory.
Yeah. Do you understand?
I think the point is right now we don't understand the landscape that well that we can make a judgment one way or the other.
Yeah.
But my feeling is that, okay, if the landscape is there, if once you understand it properly and if we do find that it's the landscape is there, we have to live with it. If the theory gives you that, then that's the way nature works. What can you do? The hope is that it will not be the way nature works and we will find some way out. Mm-hmm. But I think we shouldn't be... it's not an argument against string theory. If that's the way string theory is realized in nature, it's that we have to accept it.
We have to accept it. Yeah. Yeah. This has always been the case with string theory.
Yeah.
You cannot
change.
Take what you like
exactly.
And put away what you don't
yeah.
like.
And
it counts as a single
exactly.
package.
And to this, I'll also add that my experience is that in this field, you cannot really plan your research. Because to do something, you may need some more information which you don't have at that time.
Right.
So I think you basically explore the theory in all possible ways.
As it comes.
Yeah. And then, when time is right, you'll make a breakthrough in one particular front.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let me actually ask you about one of the really big successes of string theory. This amazing connection, which many people don't actually fully understand, this holographic principle. This is rather a remarkable exact quantum equivalence between a theory of gravity where things fall, a theory of theory of gauge theory where the thing that binds the quarks together, and it's really astonishing. If you had told anybody 30 years ago that there can be such an equivalence about, and it somehow now we just have gotten used to it. But maybe we fail to communicate how deep is this development to maybe even our closest colleagues in other areas of physics. So do you want to say something about what you think is the holography has taught us, or the what is your perspective on?
Yeah, as you said, it's of course a very deep result, but on top of that, it has given us a tool to understand gauge theories, right, which is completely new. And it is true that perhaps it's not widespread among the other, I mean, widespread knowledge or widely appreciated among the other fields. But there are people in other fields who take it very seriously, right?
Like, and as we heard today in Subir's talk,
condensed matter, certainly it has made an impact. Hydrodynamics, for example, many new results in hydrodynamics has been found inspired by this correspondence.
But one would also like to learn about gravity, and somehow all these studies of holography have been in the direction of using simpler gravity, classical gravity description to learn about strong liquid purgation theories. Yeah. Maybe one day we can reverse the arrow and learn.
Exactly, yeah. So far the connection has been one way, that you use classical gravity to learn strong liquid purgation theory. I agree.
Right. Andy, you want to add something to that? Since
I'd say it's also related to, I mean, I think there's much more to be understood about it, and I would start it with, again, the Bekenstein-Hawking area entropy law, which said that the amount of information in a black hole, in a computer, the amount of bits you can put in is proportional to the volume of the computer, the amount of information you can store. But in black holes, they discovered that it's just proportional to the area. There's nothing inside. And this is somehow a very deep and fundamental statement, which we understand concretely in a few examples. And the fact that we understand it concretely in a few examples gives hope that we can understand it in a more general way.
Okay, so this was really a wonderful opportunity for me to actually talk to the Dirac medalists, and I hope also for the people who are watch this, I think it will be.
So, that's great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.